Sorry.
So it's streaming now, and I'm gonna upload an unedited version. This is me and Ed Matz about to start our very, very, very first show.
You're not wearing glasses, so I better take mine off.
Let
And
me
I can't
just.
see a bloody thing.
So this is like a 2 minute pre-show here. One second.
You know, sometimes I think people should just take the text that they trade from and throw it away.
Yeah.
The best, yeah, I mean, I'll do it this way. Go and trade on a floor for a while and see how it really works.
That's still...
then go back and pick up a textbook. Because these textbooks simplify things. Everything's black and white. Everything's so simple. So it's going up or it's going down. It's so easy to make money, you know, end all. Bloody right, yeah. And try and do it for a while. Try and do it in environments like this when people are scared proverbially, you know, and don't really understand what's going on. Once you do that, once you start learning about risk and what it involves, then that's the time to go back to your textbook and say, okay, let's apply it. How does it really work in practice? And that takes time, but what it actually does do is takes perspective.
Yeah.
You've got to love days like this. You know,
it's a great day for trading.
Yeah, it's. I tell you, I got a phone call this morning because the markets were moving. Actually, they're moving up overnight, and I was expecting this to happen on the open. So I got a call saying, "Ed, you know, it's like the Dow was hitting 230, and am I going to try and sell it now or whatever?" So I got a call, and then so my day started at 5.
Yeah.
And then I start thinking about what's going on, then looking at the European Opens. Normally, I stumble into the European Opens with, you know, my coffee and my eyes bleary, but I was quite sharp on this one, and the day goes from there. And then the next thing you know is I'm absolutely knackered, and New York hadn't even opened. And this is probably one of the biggest, most important New York Opens we've seen in probably this year.
This is good.
Because a lot of people out there are, you know, there's been a lot of talk, 1929, you know, Wall Street crash, market opens strong, does nothing, ramps back up, goes sideways, then suddenly there's a trigger, you know, and it's starting through the yen. It's obviously EM, emerging market related, Argentina, all that stuff, and the yen is telling you a story that watch out. And then next thing you know is the Dow, the S&P, the DAX, all these markets start coming off, and everyone's thinking, is this the big one? Is this really a crash, or is this, you know, someone like myself, irrational exuberance, major bull market, everyone's trying to pick a top. Is this at some point in the next 24 hours, 48 hours, 2 to 3 days, however it pans out, is this an opportunity to buy into it again? Because basically being a buyer for quite a while. And, you know, it comes down to how it trades on this open and the level of volatility and probably into the close. And we talked about this before. It's the hardest thing today.
Yeah.
Whatever position you have will be to go home with those positions on the close.
So yeah. I just tweeted out the link now to the show, and so we're getting a few people on, and we're just like waiting for a few, like a minute, and then we're just starting. So I think you're right. It's one of the hardest days in a very long time, in one of the hardest climates to trade.
And I tell you what, it's going to be one of the hardest weekends as well, because...
Yeah, it's going to be a horrible weekend for a lot of people.
It's going to be... Well, it's a fantastic... It's funny, for someone like myself, like a trader, I just live for Monday, you know? How sad is that? I mean, don't get me wrong, I've got a lovely family life, etc. I don't do nothing but trade, but it's a buzz, and a market like this is a buzz, win or lose, right or wrong. But, you know, going into this weekend with big positions is going to be a tall order.
Yeah, and I'm looking at the guys who are sitting around me here on the pier. Everyone is long, and everyone is I mean, people are loaded up with equity longs. And you're seeing these big EM sell-offs. It's not a comfortable position to be in. But let's just start. I'm going to press record, and let's get going. Welcome to the first ever recording of Big TV that's not in like beta mode, but we're still very much beta. You are watching like a Friday night trial of an unnamed trading show I want to call Fill or Kill. And I'm here with my partner in crime, Ed Matz, who doesn't like the name Fill or Kill at all. Say hi, Ed.
Hi. Well, no, it's Deal or No Deal, or Fill or Kill, or let's just make merry, whatever. It's call it what you like. It's a trading show, trading approach, trading whatever.
So you were talking about right before the 30 cameras on that this is a very unique market, and you it's been like a completely different approach for you, and you say it's one of the like you live for days like this. Can you elaborate or repeat what you said earlier?
Yeah, well, it's different and not different, because I was saying it's the first day of this year like this we've seen, and the background is, you know, we've got the last 24, 48 hours, we've seen some big stuff going through, emerging markets collapsing, people talking about, you know, the big collapse, the market being relatively long. In the background is, you know, people have been saying for quite a while that, you know, the Dow Jones, S&Ps have been overstretched. This is a 1929 crash, you know, all it's done is basically gone up and gone sideways. Then suddenly, for the first time this year, you're actually seeing signs of weakness, and you're seeing triggers that could, you know, it could conceivably turn into a crash. And that's what worries people, particularly people long, as to how that's going to materialize. Now, that's compounded simply by the fact that a lot of people, and I include myself, are not entirely sure about the fundamentals behind this at the moment. You know, it's there seems to be a flight out of inequality, a flight to quality, a movement away, people getting jittery. But until you see, you know, until you justify it fundamentally as to what's going on, it's hard really to jump for funds, you know, for a longer term investor. For a trader like me, all I need to do is see price action and smell fear and whatever, and then see and act accordingly on the basis of the chart. And it looks like the market's going to, it's scared.
Yeah.
And it's going to break. The market's broken a couple of levels in the last few hours, but also in the last day or so, which means the first reaction, the first reaction whenever you get a sell-off is you typically see the market buy it back up into the next open. So in this case, in the case of New York, you've seen the Dow and the S&Ps come off, the DAX, FTSE, and the drifting back up into the open. Now, it's quite typical. People are unsure of how they're going to react on the open, so they square. And what will happen, what I think is pretty clear to me is going to happen, the first reaction is, yeah, they'll buy it, they're not going to sustain the rally, and they'll sell into it. And there are people who have got positions, they've gone through the levels, they'll sell. They're going to bail out. And so the first pressure, I think, for the first hour, 90 minutes, those people follow me will know, follow a cycle on the Dow called TikTok, where I expect to see the market push lower. And that, for me,
how much lower? Can you say expectations in percentages?
The Dow, I think, will break the 1.6 level. The DAX, I'm looking for, some people will know why, but I'm looking for a 94, the figure handle, levels like that. And then, you know, certainly I'm going to take back shorts, and I've got some hedges on longs, so I'll take those back, and which means effectively I'll be long options into the weekend, which in a situation like this, that's my plan at the moment, unless I see any reason otherwise. Is probably the best trading vehicle for me.
So you want to bet on volatility, basically?
Kind of. If it goes back up, vol will fall. This is tin hat time. People are buying, going to be buying options, buying puts to protect the position. So volatility will be ticking up as it goes down. And if it recovers, first reaction may be a bit of vol going back up. But the volatility will just traditionally go down as if the when the market recovers. So for me, it's quite easy from a position of having calls that I've hedged. I'll just take off the hedges at lower levels when it gets quite extreme, hopefully it gets quite extreme, and that allow me to go into the weekend. If I've got some cash positions, I'll probably square them, unless I'm really comfortable squaring with the reasons why this is happening. You know, I've got I'm talking about another market, currency market. I tend to be more of a currency specialist, my background. But I've got something like Euro-Yen has been following a fractal. Fractal is something that's happened before. It's followed it to the tick. And so I should be buying now I'm struggling to buy because of the risk. You know, if it ramps 150 points and I've got a clear stop loss, I can do that.
But let's talk about yen b when you bring it up, because yen has been, we've seen a huge sell-off for dollar yen in the last 24 hours. Is
Yeah,
it a sentiment thing, or what's going on there?
it's risk aversion. It's the crudest currency version of risk aversion, isn't it? You know, there's a doubt in the world. There's the proverbial is going to hit the fan, then you buy yen. That people talked about, and rightly so, some of the correlations breaking down of late, and we've seen the yen in a bear market, major bear market, which is debatably still in. And it's broken some of the correlations there. But at the end of the day, when something hits the market like this, it's you go to things like gold, you know, you bail out of euro, you go into the yen. Traditionally, you would have gone into the Swiss franc. So it kind of makes the yen and certain markets like that even more important because the Swiss franc is now, actually, it's wrong to say it's a dead issue because the Swiss franc's strengthened quite a lot in the last 48 hours. But given that it's got it trapped in its range, it's not such a great vehicle. So the world is worried, it's risk aversion. You know, currency perspective, you focus on the yen.
Yeah, I'm bringing
And
up
given
the
that.
dollar yen chart right here, and I you mentioned both gold and the Swissie. It's not something you hear most lately. And do you see a pickup of focus on it or not?
Well, it all comes down to saying trade, really. I think this is a fake out across the board. And so it means for me, I'm trading it short term because I'm a great believer in money. I'm a great believer in actually trading with the trend until I think closer to the time, I think it's going to reverse for two reasons. One, it gives me some P&L to try and buck it. It also gives me in the market, in a rhythm with the market, whereas I can look at myself and say, what am I thinking here? I'm sure. What should I do? You know, am I going to be greedy about it? And it helps me actually go reverse the position.
Yeah.
Certainly from a stock market point of view, I'm sitting short.
But looking at this gold chart here from that this is intraday,
Yeah.
and I mean the spike here coincided with the spike in the euro dollar, fairly a fairly similar move, and as far as I can tell, there's no real fundamental reason for this, so it's all technical at this point.
Technical is the wrong word. Technical in the sense that it's an expression of supply and demand of in a market that's driven by sentiment.
Well, I mean technical levels and these things and
Yeah,
stop
no, it's a
loss.
sentiment market. Yeah, but the world, you know, everyone's looking at 137, the figure, the 50% of the decline. For me, we needed a spike. I'm not convinced necessarily the spike's over, but I was, you know, for me, I'm fading it.
Fading gold?
No, I'm selling the euro, basically.
Yeah. And that was I mean you told me this as it was happening, and that
I
was a
was trading. I
complete
was trying to do a
reversal.
trade while speaking to you. You were quite invasive at the time, but there you go.
I'm sorry. But you look at this, I mean this was a beautiful fade. This move was a very odd move, and I mean I don't have any much
Yeah,
technical.
I wasn't expecting it. I mean, I was expecting it. Quite frankly, I thought it would probably happen on Monday. You see, that type of price action you often see on what I call a weekend axis, late Friday, Sunday, Monday type of thing, when it's a thin market, people are too frightened to get involved. Often, you know, on a Monday morning, sometimes you see, you know, people buy it out and start the week completely the wrong way around. That's a beautiful 5-way down.
Yeah,
That means to me we've seen the first leg of something down. So what would be nice, now this kind of works. This is what I look for in a situation like this across the board is I've got a couple markets like the DAX, the Dow. I think they're all going to go push to new lows, hopefully push to new lows. But something like the euro could well struggle, and you start getting divergence. Whereas before, everything's moving roughly in sync. All the markets, there's breadth to the move, means there's a real move.
yeah.
As the market gets tired, what you see is you see other segments within the market breaking off, saying, I'm done, thank you very much. Euro yen started doing it a bit. Now you're seeing the euro. It looks like it may have actually topped, which is a bit annoying because I was looking for one further high. But if it goes back up and starts failing, that's going to be a trigger, watch out. And if it's a trigger of watch out on the euro, given that the euro is rallying as stocks are coming down, it's a flag. It's a flag for the stock
But
markets.
let's talk a little bit about why this is happening. I mean, the famous Soros quote is "Trade first, ask why later," or something like that. But
When
now a
did
lot of
George
them.
Soros say that? It's very.
We did say something like that.
No, but when did he say it?
I don't know.
I'm not taking issue whether he said it or not.
No, he did.
I
Trade
suspect
f
that was
no,
like
it's
15
trade
years ago.
first,
Did he say it?
investigate later.
Because I don't know if that's so true. Information moves so quickly now.
Yeah.
We're in a position to know why, or should be in a position to know why, much more quickly. In
Well,
fact, we're
nothing moves
almost.
faster than price action, though. So, I think that's the sentiment he was trying to get across. But now we've had some time for this to rest, and a lot of people have been asking what was up with the overall risk-off movement yesterday. And as far as I can figure, it's the bad data out of China is probably a trigger. You have all these global geopolitical issues like Ukraine, especially the potential contagion from Argentina. If it's artificial or not, it's probably not a direct contagion, but still, I mean, Argentina is a really it's a problematic area right now. And then on top of that, you have Turkey, which have similar problems. So basically, you're seeing huge currency fluctuations in both countries. Do you think that this is a trigger where you could see a lot of gap moves over the weekend? And how would you trade this? Do you actually trade this, or do you sit this one out?
No, I do trade it. But you trade it. I have a mantra, sorry, trade from strength. So I will only go into a position with a naked cash position with some degree of comfort. So in other words, if I'm going to get buried, then at least I'm going to be losing some profit before I sustain a loss. Primarily because I focus more on technical analysis, on charts, on price action, supply and demand, rather than necessarily the news events. This being a good example now, without really knowing what's going on and why, my Bible is my chart. And my chart's telling me something, then I should abide by it. The only problem is it's maybe a Bible, but it could cost me a fortune. So I need to manage my risk. So to answer your question, I will follow my charts to the extent I can manage my risk. And then the question really becomes, what risk are we talking about in terms of gap down, gap ups? I've got options on board on one or two markets, so my risk is limited. Will I take, if I can build a degree of comfort, trade from a position of strength, then I will go with some of my ideas. But I will not carry the normal. If this carries on into the weekend, which probably will one way or the other, then I'm not going to be carrying the normal position size because, I want to be here on Monday to trade again.
Yeah. So I want to bring up something that I noticed today, kind of by accident, really. It's this new trading platform from Saxo Bank. And I wanted to show you I mentioned it briefly before, and I was in I went to see the guys at I went to see the guys at StockTwits about 4 months ago in San Diego. I met a lot of people that are like real innovators in finance, and I got to see some people who are like properly who are properly trained this whole new financial innovation industry, which is to me was almost like non-existent until I went there. And I met a couple of like three or four guys who did where you have they call it ditto trading, they call it copy trading, where you get the same execution as an expert trader. You can follow people who are like almost like pseudo money managers. And today Saxo is launching a new product. I just wanted to show you a brief video on this. You should be able to hear me now. I'm not sure if you can hear it. So basically, the guy is presenting. Let me just. Oh, yeah.
You can trade and share information. We want you to be first to experience.
Yeah, sorry. The audio is failing me a bit here.
I wouldn't worry about the audio so much as the dress sense. Is that is wearing Sun Suit or what?
You should be getting the audio now. From profile traders
and with a few but this is a copy their trades using our new. This here is a platform where you can copy traders, and I really like this idea where you have a specialist outfit like Saxo Bank, who have a fairly conventional approach to money management or to trading, and they do fairly conventional things, and Europe is much more conservative than the US when it comes to these things, and there's a number of reasons for regulatory reasons, and to see a multinational company like Saxo go in this very American direction, I think is fantastic. And I know you have some opinions on copy trading like this is. Can you share a little bit what you shared before?
Are you talking to me?
Yes.
You know, we've got about 2 minutes before the open, but I'm a professional trader. I've been trading for more than 20 years. I would never copy anyone else's trade because I need to take responsibility for something goes right or wrong. However, I'm influenced by people, and I've been fortunate, I suppose. I'm kind of have a fairly robust approach to the market, whatever, but I've had quite a few people follow me, some very seriously big names. And one thing they've always said to me, Ed, is, and people make this point, and someone made it today, in fact, on Twitter, that, yeah, I follow you, but I do my own trades. When you say something and I agree with you, I tend to double up. When you say it's against me, I tend to reduce my position, look at it again, or square up. It's a confidence factor. Now, that is when I say if you've established yourself as a trader, it's useful to have solid influences that keep you disciplined, that keep you focused. Now, if you're starting off, then you know you can take a course, you can read the textbook. I don't know if anyone heard me ranting earlier about the textbook. On a day like this, you can throw the textbook away. You know, whatever your textbook is on, it's the seat of the pants stuff. And so I would, you need to get experience, and you need shortcuts to experience. Otherwise, you'll blow your account once, twice, or thrice. And the way to do that is to follow people who've been around, who've got a record, who, you know, suggesting some trades, and you can follow them. So, you know, it wouldn't be me. Would I have liked to have done this starting off? I had mentors when I started off. Would I have copied their trades? I did very, very similar trades to them. So, yes, if you're unsure, if you're particularly when it comes to emotional elements, then copying someone who's got a record, who's doing well, it's not just about experience, but someone who's on a roll, then I think is actually probably a good idea. Yeah. The thing you need to do at all times is to take responsibility for your own actions. That applies generally in life, but also for trading. Because if the I always want to swear, if it goes wrong, then you're the one who's got to carry the can. You've got to justify what you've done, and but, never risk anything you can't afford.
But here's the number one. I hope this is a real account. It's done 300 and something trades. It's got an 80% win ratio. It closed 112 trades, and you get a fairly decent shot. Actually, this is like a fairly decent hedge fund in if you look at the.
You didn't mention the risk return.
You know what's so interesting here?
I just noticed
something on this site. It's actually structured like a monthly report for a hedge fund. It has almost the exact same indicators on this on this page.
Why wouldn't
as a hedge fund would have.
It's the same
so
thing.
I think that what's interesting about this whole copy trading thing is when you have the world of hedge funds that are moving to becoming these like fairly dull risk-averse machines, and the days of George Soros in the early 90s are just gone. You can't make those super trades that they once did. And I just think that this is it's saying something about the current state, and if they can keep it on board with regulatory issues, I signed up immediately to this service. And
yeah, that's a big issue because with all these things, it's not just regulatory issues, but the reasons for the regulation is that people there needs to be a high degree of trust. There needs to be a high degree of financial due diligence. And people, if they're going to take risks, they need to understand fully the risks they're taking. And in that process, you know, there's a lot to be learned. Good things. Obviously, they follow some like 80% win ratio. It doesn't say, I didn't hear the risk return on the 80%, but you know, that's a very good win ratio. Someone can make a lot of money, and a lot of this is also aspirational. One reason why you'd copy someone else is not just so you can make money, because otherwise, why not just give them your money and walk away? One of the reasons is so that you can learn to do it yourself, or at least understand the nature of what you're risking. Too often we hand, well, I don't, but too often people hand over money and say, get on with it, and they actually don't know what's really happening to their money until someone turns around at the end of the, well, it's much more frequent now, but at the end of the year or the quarter and whatever, says, this is what I've done. So I think there's more and more people seem to be setting up accounts, retail accounts, in a bid to learn how to trade. There's nothing that beats trading for learning how to trade. And yeah. So you can follow someone who can hold your hand at the same time. It's not a demo account, it's actually a real account. You can watch what you're doing as well. I think, you know, people can learn, but it's absolutely crucial. There's no scope.
I've been exactly in the same spot as you were, 20 some years ago, where I was a professional journalist, and I didn't like that position, and I was so into trading as a concept. But when you're a journalist, you don't trade. I mean, it sounds silly, but you don't. And I wanted to start in the world of trading. There wasn't any option. You couldn't just start trading. And when I look at this service right here, this is what I needed at that point. And you have some.
Then you're trading traders. You're not trading necessarily a market. So who's
no,
good?
No, but
at
you
what?
Understand trading. That's what I mean. So what you get from this, what I'm seeing on this page here, is a hedge fund. This is a hedge fund, and you get to see. So in terms of if you want to invest in unconventional methods, I would pick this over almost any hedge fund, where you have so much visibility, you get to see all their trades easily, you have very low cost.
Why not use this? One thing I was kind of saying in between the lines, but I'll say it straight. If you're going to do something like this, then go to a reputable financial institution, yeah, where you someone like Saxo Bank is pretty good money. And so you're.
But this is Saxo Bank.
Sorry?
This is Saxo Bank.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Is, you know, there are people out there who do that, and I'm not going to cast aspersions. I don't know the quality or otherwise of any of them, but something like that I would go to. Quality.
Yeah,
not just the people trading, but also in terms of
Twitter,
the reputation, the creditworthiness even of those people. And Saxo is a pretty good name.
But you listen to people on Twitter, don't you? Like people you don't actually know. I mean, you do realize we've never met.
I know.
And we talk every day.
I know, I have nightmares.
Yeah. But I feel like, I mean, this like whole new kind of meeting people is truly market changing. And I don't know, I'm not trying to blow the horn of this service here, but it just said something. Like I didn't think it was able to do this regulatory in Europe, and I'm happy it's possible. And the fact that you can get pseudo hedge fund access is fantastic. And you don't trust this guy, some guy without a picture. His name is Mr. Nielsen. That's actually his name, like my name. That's his handle, seriously.
This isn't a commercial for you, trading.
No, it's Danish Nielsen. You get No, look at that. You can't see it, but on the top here it says Mr. Nielsen. So what I'm saying is just this is financial innovation that we need, and I'm just happy that we see it today. And I mean, I got contacted by people that work at Saxo Bank that hadn't heard of this service. It launched yesterday. So it's just a happy coincidence. But anyway, do you want to talk a little bit about, I know you have this like specialty you're working on, the fractals. Anything you want to pinpoint?
Yeah, there's quite a few fractals. I mentioned Euro Yen.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, I'm sitting there waiting to put a trigger on it because I'm waiting till I get what I think is the sell-off in the Dow, because, you know, the Dow goes lower, Euro Yen's going to struggle. So I'm just waiting for them to stabilize. It's sitting. The fractal on Euro Yen, I'm not going to tell it to people necessarily where, if you, you know, tune into what I do, then you'll know exactly where it is, where I'm comparing it to. But it's right on the money here.
Yeah.
Right on the money. So
what would you do?
You know, and then the Dow, I'm looking for new lows. And
but
we're sitting,
what do
you can see it on all these markets, right? They're all sitting there. But it's like everyone's sitting on there next to the cliff. And everyone's going to say, go on, just a bit nearer, I'm just watching it tip down. And it's going, in a few minutes, it's going to go whack, 20, 30, 40, 50 points lower. You know, the Dow has got a corrected value 61.40, so it's going to push.
So would you say
in the next 20, 30 minutes, once it goes through, then I'm going to be looking at something like Euro Yen, see where it is, and I'll be looking to take back my shorts on. And then probably the best thing to do, I say this tongue in cheek, is to walk away, make myself a cup of coffee, come back, look at the level, wait for another 20 points lower, and then buy it, because it may overshoot.
Yeah.
But what I'm actually describing is a capitulation day. And then the question really becomes the scale, because, and this is the difficulty, and certainly for someone like myself, because I have to understand what's going on before I can really commit or get truly involved. You know, whether I want to buy and hold this market into the weekend will depend very much on the contagion risk. It's all very well. This could be on the back of, you know, some bad numbers out of China, knocking emerging markets. Next thing you know, the yen goes, that starts triggering some longs in the stock markets. That's all very good. You know, then it's a fade out. We should look to buy it, bang, bang. But what if Argentina goes? You know, they've started doing things, haven't they, about their controls. What if something else gets triggered that actually has a real impact? As you talked about George Soros, this is someone who waxes lyrical about the impact of what markets do. Markets can actually affect, it may sound blindingly obvious, but markets can affect the real world. And if the real world gets affected in this little sell-off, then something else can get triggered, and that's the risk. And that's where you've got to take a call, I think. I personally do, at least on the scale of my positions. You know, I can buy Euro Yen here with a 50 point stop, and 50 points is 50 points. And if it goes on a Friday, I'm covered. If it gaps 100 points, 150 points on the weekend, I'm going to be annoyed.
But this is really a potential gap weekend, though. It's uncomfortable to sit.
Well, actually, this is what is so good about this. Is I actually think this is the opposite. This is a non-existent gap. I want to see the price action now and then close strong. Yeah. If it doesn't, then I won't be carrying the size positions that I want to. What I'm looking for is an opportunity when people get really meltdown on this is a typical Friday price action as well. You know, gap down on Friday, break to new lows, the world's going to end, you know, and then, oh, I can't carry my positions into the weekend, and then they get squeezed, and then it starts recovering from after the first 90 minutes. The TikTok low is what I'm looking for in the first 60 to 90 minutes, and then I'll be buying. Yeah. Do I seem nervous?
A little bit, yeah, a little antsy. Maybe it's because the S&P is at year low. Oh, year-to-date low, I know.
Yeah, well, not...
I'm watching about a significant sell-off.
Seven markets here, and wondering, you know, I'm short. Sure, it's not going, is it? Talk amongst yourselves.
Anyway, I think that's probably a nice place to end. I mean, this was supposed to be just a test of this new show. But I think it went fairly well. I thoroughly enjoyed myself. What do you think?
I was just Chris Vecchio from FXCM was saying, see, this is what I need to know. If anyone is listening in on Twitter, just if you've got a good handle on what is really going on, then I'd appreciate this, because it's going to affect how the positions I take into the weekend.
Yeah, I saw it.
FXCM says EM concerns, systemic maybe. All European emerging markets being grouped together is problematic for A11. But it doesn't actually get to the core of it, yeah? I mean, what's the biggest risk out there? Is it Argentina? What's the big risk on Argentina on the weekend?
I mean, I don't even know.
What do they do Argentina? Oh. You probably find the Argentines only ever do things on Wednesdays. You know, that's the problem scale of... I have been to Argentina. I actually timed my visit really well. It was just... devaluation time, but that's beside the point. but yeah, if there's anyone who really understands can really encapsulate what the nature of the risk is this weekend, then I'll be able to take some positions into the weekend.
Yeah.
But it's going. Come on, only a few more points. You see, and euro yen is holding up. But it's not. It's not now. It's when, you know. I'd love to see the 16,000 level broken on the Dow. You know, it's just something like that. Something
why do you watch the Dow? For sentiment?
No, I mean, no. It's historic. You know, it's obvious. The S&P is better in every sense. It's a better bellwether, has more liquidity, has greater number of companies in it, so it's a more valid market. It's just the clarity of the price action. I'm a price action trader. I have technical analysis, and I find the levels. Historically, this is over time, the levels, the price action is clearer and cleaner. Maybe for that reason, maybe because of everyone is trading it, so much noise in the S&P. Maybe it's the algos, you know, the HFTs and everything else are distorting it. I find the Dow to be clearer and give me a better handle. Quite often, I will trade the S&P on the back of the Dow and not the other way around. Although saying that of late, in the last in this last stage of the bull market, actually the S&P has been clearer.
So maybe here I'm just bringing up two charts here. The black line is Dow Jones and the orange line is S&P. I mean, they're correlating, but there are surprisingly
different.
They're less close than I would think they are. And actually, it's probably, I remember in crisis days, that was a problem that the Dow didn't work at all. Like in a real crisis, because it's such
crisis
a small sample.
Days, you know, that was bizarre. You know, it's just like, can't S&P limit down? Whack, where's the yen gone for 150 points? You know, it's almost on the tick. And you could trade, it was weird, when there was no price in the S&P, you could pick up a dollar yen or euro yen chart and see what the S&P was actually supposed to be doing, because it was, you can trade the yen. Here we go. I reckon, what's the time? Quarter to? No, we've got about another 50 points in this.
What are you looking at?
The Dow. I'm looking closer to 16,000. This is right. Well, for me, 61. I don't know how to ever say this. 16,100 on the Dow is the line in the sand on the upside now.
Yeah.
So we should just push down. But,
anyway, I think we should call it a day now. It's been a good show. So before we mess it up, it's better to end it, I think. So we're gonna be doing this. Daily, I think, and we're going to be doing a lot of shows, especially in the mornings in Europe, and eventually it's going to be just all the time. So I'm going to be taking up a lot of Ed's time, and we're going to be talking even more like this, if you don't mind.
Me? Yes. Or you mean everyone else?
Well, yeah, both. Oh yeah, do follow me on Twitter, do follow Ed on Twitter, maybe he's a little bit more interesting. But he's on StockTwits as well, and yeah.
Well, hopefully, Sverry won't be. I won't be so distracted.
No.
Because that's part. It's part of one reason we talked about this. One reason I want to do this. There's so many reasons. Because Twitter's. You know, I love Twitter. It, actually, all of this. People ask me, why do you do this? And one of the reasons is I get a buzz out of talking about things I love, as we all do.
Yeah.
But also because it's focus. Yeah. I mean, I'm quite an energetic. Can be. I do a lot more trades than people probably see on Twitter. I can trade the hind leg of a donkey off, probably badly, but and so this helps me doing tweets and stuff like that, talking about markets in a structured way keeps me disciplined.
Yeah.
So talking about what I'm doing, now, for example, in this last setup on the Dow, it started dithering just above the previous low. I might have sitting there overanalyzing, looking at the markets, decided I'll take it back. But because I've been talking, it's actually kind of made me just stop, hold, wait for new lows. I mean, that's a bad example, but it's still an example of the type of reasons why I use Twitter.
Yeah.
And, you know, you articulate concepts. If you can't articulate it, then you don't understand the concept well yourself. So the whole process for me is a discipline. And so hopefully the reason for doing this is that we can all benefit, and that it's disciplined, it's rigorous, but it's, you know, at the end of the day, it's still human, because we're in it for human reasons. Basically, we want to do well.
So I like that sentiment. On that note, I think we're going to end the recording.
Very profound Friday afternoon night.
So okay. We're going to be on earlier. We're probably going to be Yeah, we're going to be on all the time. So I'm going to leave the stream on for a little while, but I'm going to end the recording now. And thank you guys. I know a lot of people helped us on Twitter to spread it. We're going to be in every channel, everywhere. It's we're going to be hard to miss, hopefully. So thanks, Ed, and thanks, everyone, for watching.
Cheers.
Cheers. That was good, wasn't it? Ed.
Me?
Yeah.
Can't think of a worse time
to have
done this. Yeah, I mean, at least Euro Yen wasn't falling 200 points.
No, hopefully you made money from not trading.
That's almost funny and actually a little bit wicked, really actually.
We just stumbled upon a business idea for you.
Yeah. Set my hands. Yeah.
By the way, the stream is still live, so we have a few people watching, but it doesn't matter.
No, it's fine. I never have anything to hide. Well, that's all right. So if I don't care now, I'm out. The question now is whether it's going down at further 50 points. It's going to, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's going to. But I'm not getting in. This is divergence time, yeah? This is... I'll tell you one thing. I mean, for all the wonders of modern technology, if I was sitting in a pit, I'd have a much better idea. You'd stare at people in their eyes, and they'd be looking like, and they'd be looking at me, for example. Like, you know, they think this guy actually can be good at times, he can be bad at other times, but they're looking at me. They'd be looking at me, looking at them, looking at me.
Yeah.
And you could get a much better idea of what's going on now. You know, it's just looking at a chart. But then, you know, this is, I suppose, in a way, the beauty of having, for me, having that experience is that chart to me represents those faces, you know, those positions. So it's kind of interesting. Oh dear. Right. Anything else? What else?
Just popped its cherry.
No, but thanks so much, Ed. And I'm just going to leave the stream on a little bit, but pretty much I think we're done for today. We had two shows we wanted to do, both Stocks and Scotch and an interview with a really cool guy. Both got postponed until Monday or next week or whatever. So,
okay.
So thank you for helping me pop my cherry.
Howard on, are you doing it anyway?
Well, I'm not going to sit here, drink scotch and talk about finance myself. So I think we're going to postpone it, the relaunching of that show until next week. I think it's in Aspen skiing or something. So that's what I saw on Twitter.
Okay. Someone said, great stuff. Keep it up.
Yeah.
What's TV but big?
Big TV. I don't know. Big TV is the stupidest name we could have come up with. We can't find it anywhere. The domain is like $10,000. So, and we have to use all these hacks to get around having the most like generic name. It's like having, it's like calling a shop.
Why? Commerce. Why? This is a Friday afternoon. The DAX is going on and the Dow's stopped. I mean, what's that about? It never happens. That's someone bailing out on the DAX. What's the time? Two, three. It's 10 to 4.
But you talk algo action. I mean, the DAX is most likely something like that, isn't it?
Well, you'd think. Yeah. That fractal. We never talked about the fractals. Did I divert myself?
Yeah, you went in 10 directions at once. So it was hard. No, you talked about fractals that I didn't have. So you had to talk about them.
Things like that. I mean, it's kind of cool because it's real.
But what we can do on fractals is, I set up a computer here that you can take over. I need a local computer you can run stuff off of. That's the best way to do it.
I it's funny because I watched, it's a guy I really like, Jamie Sotelli. He's really good, actually. Again, an AFXEM guy. He's not paying me to say this, but I saw he was doing a webinar with Dale. What's he called? The LAR, FX Street.
Yeah.
And Jamie was being, Dale was interviewing him, and he was, I thought Jamie had had too much coffee or something. He was down, hunkered down, and he was kind of rocking sideways. His head was all over the place. I thought, this is very strange. But I'm doing it the same myself now. He was probably being talked to, he was interviewed at a time when there was loads of markets moving around. He's got a few positions. So, you know, he's quite happy to do the interview, but quite frankly, he'd rather just be trading. But, you know, it's no problem. And I feel like I'm kind of bobbing and weaving around the same way. And now I understand why he was doing what he was doing. It's kind of interesting.
Yeah.
Which maybe I need to, am I moving around too much?
No, you're brilliant.
Brilliant.
You're a beautiful young man.
Well, there you go. The fact you called me young means I'm not beautiful. Thanks.
So it's all a lie. It's like every part of it. You're not a man. No, but so what
that's
I want to.
9470. Hang on.
So this is what I want to do. Remember, I told you that I want hour slots.
Yeah.
So you can continue the conversation even though you're not live anymore or you're not recording anymore, and that's what I'm doing now. So I think this is a good way to solve the in betweens.
Yeah, that's cool. Just I just hate that. Swear for me, will you? How do I say proverbial shit without swearing?
Just say proverbial shit. Shit's not swearing. It's only in the States that's swearing. And it's not being recorded anyway, so.
It was earlier. I said proverbial.
Oh, wait, it is, because it's on YouTube. Fuck.
Well, I do. You know what? One of the reasons we talked about this before. One thing I do get excited by is the reality. I hate things like Big Brother and programs like that. Really hate them, and I think they're fake and they're false.
Yeah.
But their appeal,
yeah,
is that it's live, it's here and now, it's not scripted, it's therefore real, but it's fake. So yeah. What I really like about this type of thing, and I think about the future of media, probably television as well. I mean, television hasn't really gone down this path yet. Is reality. Do a real Big Brother. Don't fake it. You know, go and shove a. You can never get it exciting enough. But probably if you put a camera in the right place, you can make it exciting. But
well, I know some people like this, but most people are incredibly dull, though. So in order to make this work, like what we're doing now, you actually have to plan. You have to have some kind of outline. You have to have somebody that knows what they're at least like faking that they know what they're talking about, or at least can can point other people that know what they're talking about in the right direction. And if you just go on, like you do reality, like actual reality TV, it's going to be horrendous. I don't know.
But yeah, no, I meant in terms of something being real. Yeah. No, you need structure.
But have you seen those Storage Wars shows? Like the ones that they go and they buy storage lockers. Have you seen that? And then yesterday I saw one of these shows that came after it became popular. So it's like the sort of second generation of it. I think it's called Storage something. And it was so blatantly fake. Everyone was an actor. Everyone was like a character playing a role. And they had like all these, like, they were very clear, very different looking. And you saw that?
Was it you that tweeted the one about the tow truck?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, tow truck thing is amazing. I'm gonna put it on so you're supposed to. Do you hear the whole room now, or?
Yeah.
Can you hear the other people now?
Hi, Ed.
Ed, can you hear other people now?
Yeah, I can hear in the background. Yes.
Anyway, so just. Off the stream now, and I just have to talk to some people here, and thanks for staying on with me, and it was fun. So I guess we're gonna do the same on Monday.
Are we? Okay.
Or not.
Hang on, just
okay.
No. I'm looking at the
Thanks for bearing with us.
Oh,
peace out. Editing.